You are listening to Off Planet Radio at offplanetradio.com.
Well, welcome again to Off Planet Radio. I'm Randy Moggins, and I'm here with Emily Moyer and Aug Tellez, and we're just going to do a session. We're going to try and unwind, unpack, unziplock a whole bunch of concepts that have to do with temporal geomagnetic navigation. These are not topics that are real easy to break out. Aug's been doing extensive writing and videos and putting out a lot of data and a lot of information. And I think between the three of us, we kind of have a common sense of where this is all going. And in some ways, we've kind of been like the Tower of Babel, because we've been broken in terms of a communications method that got things boiled down to simple aspects. So we're just going to keep trying. We're going to keep plugging on it. So welcome to the show. And Aug and Emily, good evening.
Hello. Thanks for joining us, Aug.
Hi, thank you.
So let me open the salvo here with Aug's article posted yesterday. And these articles are posted on Aug's. They're posted on the... Aug, tell people where your website is, by the way.
AugTellez.wordpress.com.
Okay. And also on Facebook, if you are friended up there, you're seeing Aug's articles on Facebook. He posted something yesterday, and we're going through synchronicities right now, because I'm getting downloads, and Emily and I are vetting information, trying to make sense out of some of these things, because all of us have memories, and a lot of this stuff's getting unlocked, which I think is being allowed to happen now. As we're coming together, we're also kind of unlocking each other. There's this synergistic thing that happens. All of us have different experiences. All of us come from different places, but all of us are connected. And so these concepts that we're trying to pull out of each other and ourselves, and this is really a painful process in a lot of ways. So let me read the opening of this article that Aug posted onto Facebook, and I'm just going to read the excerpt here. It says, the primary layers of the wholeness of the higher dimensional geometries are the key to resolving the holographic fractal infection paradox of this universe. Instead of looping endlessly from one fractal layer to another, one must recreate the entire image within themselves and then place themselves within that image. This is how one orients within the larger universe and escapes the endless repeating labyrinth of the fractal holographic construct which has been programmed. Aug, you want to kind of launch off of that? And the reason why I opened with that article is because it was the unifying, it was kind of the fulcrum for a thought progression.
Oh yeah.
And part of it had to do with some downloads that I got that had to do with my understanding of how in the programs we were taught to navigate. Now, your navigation subject in your post is a little bit more expansive in terms of navigating a larger sphere a larger space, because what you're talking about is navigating more of a quanta, whereas I was actually talking about geolocation, geonavigation, and aspects that had to do with basically operations. But where they come together has to do with this internal system of navigation, which I thought was the key to what you posted there. And then obviously what you're talking about with a video that you put out as well, it has to do with being able to access a more holistic function of our consciousness in order to be able to move in and out of different temporal spaces. And just feel free to jump in anywhere with that.
Yeah. I go to a different outline. I'm trying to figure out how to like break into the information. There's the first thing that comes to mind, as well as the acknowledgement, you know, the basic acknowledgement of those aspects of the operations, the programs, training, the capabilities, and what that indicates about the universe and consciousness for the most part, and how there's really an interplay between biological consciousness and some type of higher awareness that kind of, it has these capabilities that kind of, they're senses, if you will. It's like a sensate process, yeah, rather than like a linear, you know, assertion or assertion of kind of like a thought process. It is, the methods that people are taught are broken down into basically being able to function or operate these skills, these like Latin capabilities at will. To is literally like to use them, like you can pull out, use a calculator or something, whether it's, you know, navigation or a form of control of an individual or psychological assessing strategy and you know, for certain situations. And so then beyond that, then the first idea is that there are kind of two ways to look at this, as far as the more mystical, if you will, it may be even slightly Gnostic, if people want to talk of it, speak of it this way, regard it that way, information and experience, or knowledge, I'm sorry, I'm being verbose today, I usually am, regarding the internal navigation of what is more or less termed as the cosmos, and how through this internal navigation and alignment, and basically these sacred, maybe sometimes geometrical, geometric patterns, processes that one steps through with their energy, through their awareness, so mm-hmm. they're making an effort to do this, that one, in a way, navigates what people call outer space, which is another way of saying the, if you will, hyper-expanded or hyper-real inner space, which is what the Gnostics described as the inner cosmos and the different frequency layers, and basically, like you were saying, a larger term operation or application of this type of geomagnetic sensing and organizing of energies of the individual within this temporally and spatially local environment we could call the Cartesian basically the coordinates. I can't think of the word right now. And then using that to connect with and navigate through some type of overlay of magnetic information or some other energetic field, which our physical biological systems may not be directly entangled with, but access through whatever function is enabled by basically a soul being within a physical body, our awareness activating the magnetite in our foreheads and the brain plugging into this morphogenic field, this magnetic field through the mm-hmm. polarity of every cell all the way down to our DNA, because, you know, the presence is there, into some type of larger organism, which we're in a way an extension of, as well as operating through. And so yeah, maybe that kind of just blew the doors open without really narrowing anything down, but there are processes of that, and it's really kind of simple. Maybe one way is it's the way the eyes work. You have bioptic vision, and they extend out and form a point to connect at whatever you're focusing on. Your brain
right
does all this judgment for you, And I'm sure, you know, in an infantile state, we kind of, it takes a little bit of time before we can really grasp what's going on.
That was exactly, okay, let me stop you right there, because that was exactly one of the points that Emily and I were talking about. And I brought this up and I wrote it. I've written articles on this. When we are young, we are trained to, we have to be taught to do frontal vision focusing, which basically means we defocus off of our spherical range of our eyes, our natural corneal circumferential. Well, it's hemispheric, basically. What most people don't realize is that the eye itself is lined with optical nerves that go the whole way back across the cornea that actually extend into the same hemisphere of the brain that is used for visual processing, but it is not what you call the iris and the retina. It's the cornea itself, which is what encompasses peripheral vision. And everything about our culture is training us to use full frontal vision so that, for instance, you will, today we're trained by television. We look forward, we stare directly at the object that's directly in front of us. When you're in a classroom setting, which is where most of us get a lot of our training, we're told to look forward. Everything that we do teaches us to focus forward and to narrow our vision only in that way. What I learned and what I've understood and done pretty much without ever thinking about it is defocusing from that frontal vision and moving to peripheral vision. And that peripheral vision opens up another field of vision that not only opens up the landscape around you another probably 30 degrees on each side, but also enables you to begin to discern movements, colors, shadows, and things that are not normally in the range of the normal eyesight. So that's the nutshell summation of where I was going on the full on the use of frontal vision focusing versus the use of peripheral vision.
Oh, yeah, this goes right into it. Now I'm going back to the mind map version of writing this down. Because you immediately bifurcated into two streams of that fractal inner cosmos and how the biological organism, how that is referenced, you know, physically, temporally in this type of Cartesian environment.
Yeah.
And so the peripheral vision is part of all of this, part of the even the training of teaching one to use that aspect of not only their vision but their consciousness, because how we interact with our environment is going to basically create the outline or the parameters for what we're capable of basically processing mentally.
Yeah.
So if we're used to basically being on a conveyor belt of information being plopped down, organized, packaged right in front of us and sent in front of our sensory system, we're not going to have access to that field that's off to the side. And that's the whole point of all of this. And
exactly,
it was described to the degree where even how like these some of these kind of mystical practices of gazing and defocusing and all that stuff, if you look into any of that, how that basically gets the mind to begin operating on these variables, these senses that are not specifically limited to what we see physically,
yes,
visibly from our eyes and by the conscious mind, meaning it begins to allow the subconscious, yes, to begin processing. And it's literally like, when done safely, it's like safely overclocking a computer processor, where you realize you're capable of widening the field of vision both physically and metaphorically through an information processing system, and you begin processing reality differently. And the last thing I want to slip in there, which this goes into so many different layers here, is that this is what I talked about in the video. At one point, I reached this, actually at the beginning. So basically, there, now imagine doing this with your processing of time, because that's basically space, getting that cone, that focal point, and you kind of, you don't invert it, you don't, you know, like look inside behind you. but you begin to go around the edges. And so imagine it's the same thing where we have a single point, and then that goes down into a cone where we're magnifying the present moment. And it's really kind of flipped to the point where we come from an expanse and go down into an infinitesimally small present moment. In a sense, it could also invert itself, where it could be both, because we're magnifying the infinitesimally small moment so that we can experience it. But in the same sense, when we begin to try to localize that, you know, any definitive quality of it, it becomes an infinitesimally small point that we can't. As soon as we're aware of it, by definition, it's gone. That's the whole point. And so the idea is some of these experiments, studies, you know, a large portion of a main chunk of how this world functions. And basically the secret, I'll just put it like that, the unveiling of what we're going to learn and how this works is that the conscious mind, as we're aware of, has a very limited amount of processing given to us consciously for the present moment through the short-term memory. And then there's something very interesting, and there's a few different ones. There's an echoic memory, where if you've heard a word, or somebody asks you something and you're just like doing something else, and then 3 or 4 seconds later you snap to and answer the question or whatever it was, just because it was basically in background processing. And then there's the same as echoic vision, which is just echoic memory, where you could be on the example they give in psychology is you're on the side of the road and there's somebody doing something strange on the side and you just drive by, and then, you know, 3 seconds later, half mile down the road, you go, wait, what was that?
Okay.
So there's all this processing happening that we're not actually, like, if we're at a conveyor belt and we're one of the workers checking everything as it goes, half of the stuff that goes through, we're not checking. The idea is it's really more close to 90%. And if we actually could see what's going by, we gain access to a completely different realm of experience with a different orientation that is, it's looked like another world. And so the main idea here is the short-term memory and the long-term memory, they act in tandem to function and generate basically a personality by a trading of, there's a diagram in the video, childhood memories where these deep-seated fears and attractions and you know, alignment of our personality is formed. And then a little bit later on, adolescent and mature memory, where we develop a continued relationship basically with reality and the world. And it generates, you can draw a diagram of this, it generates a personality that's based upon that memory. That's why they say in a lot of these projects and a lot of these, you know, unveiling other people talking about this stuff, that the memory can be manipulated. If people go by memory, they can, the sands of time can shift and do shift. That was something somebody wrote recently. It's been mentioned many times before. But the idea is that memory is, if you're not aware of this process, that memory is all a person has to go off of for their personality and the reality and the environment they're in. With the information, the processes, the projects, the experiences, it is determined that that memory is largely basically back written information that's maintained basically by the brain BSing us on whatever it thinks that we should accept in order to know who we are, where we've been, and what we're in. Meaning when we go back through all the details, the majority of them are kind of just sloppy, they're just made up. And so whether that's because we're operating in these different timelines, as if we're kind of shifting in and out, and we're the awareness that tends to jump from place to place, body to body, if you will, or whether it's just because we're dummies where our brains don't work well, and we kind of, to make up for that while we're doing all this other processing, we're used to over thousands of years of adaptation to the brain just BSing the entirety of our background story of the universe, or not, you know, that's to be decided. But although it's kind of everything here comes down to it being both, to us both being the exact representation that we have. And it's like, yeah, I am that character that did this, and there's all these qualities that I think and selectively remember and selectively hold attention to. And as well, it's a plethora of stuff that goes all the way outside of the bounds, because that's what's contained in the universe. And the area that we're not consciously aware of is still us, but it's part of the shadow aspect of our being. Whereas that focal point that we are conscious of, it is as well us, and it is only capable of being here because that area that we're unaware of exists. But the weird thing is, what happens when you begin to use technology, some of these mind-enhancing for altering chemicals, some of these sacred processes, or simply recording yourself 24/7 for, you know, 15 years or something? What happens when you then compare your biological version of reality and the real thing? main idea here is what happens when you set up an AI system to monitor what happens to you while you go into different worlds or dreams or something like that. And then when you come back with the memories and the system now records and tells you, well, no, while you remembered going here to A to B and then these memories are, you know, complete, really these energies came here by some sort of externalized intention or objective system that kind of cut your memory off here and stitched you together on a different plane here. And there's all these processes that are as if it's like we're in a mainframe or a factory that is ran and operated largely by operations, entities, or simply functions that go outside of our conscious perception. But we're riding the waves of those influences 24/7. We're just not realizing it. The last
you raise a good point here. We are constantly processing a full spectrum of information. But from that spectrum, we're constricting down to, again, that funnel, that tube, the point of focus. Nevertheless, all that data is still streaming past us. And then it becomes kind of almost like a total recall scenario. How much of that data can you grab? And Emily jumped off here for a minute, but she's talked about this, and I've mused about it as well, the fact that one of the reasons why, especially in projects, they liked using kids was because kids don't filter. Kids are wide open. They also tend to have very close to near perfect memory at a certain level before they begin the filtration process, before they begin editing. Because, you know, I don't know where it begins, and it's probably different for everyone, but it feels like there's a place, and you know, because you've gone back through your memories and we've gone back and worked with ours, you begin to not trust yourself at a certain level anymore because you know that you've been editing. You know that your memories may not even be your own, which is one level to it. They may be implanted, or you may have simply selectively edited them in a certain way. So in processing this field of data, we constrict it down, but we still theoretically have access to the full data stream from the very time that we came into this consciousness. Yes?
Well, that's the, now I don't want to say amazing, because I've been getting up on etymology, which we all should. And amazing just means you were stupefied by something. And so,
yeah, exactly.
So this is the all incorporating aspect, that there's a way. It's in the DNA, it's in the cells, and then cell means you're locked in the body trap, that cellular geometric geodesic dome trap. Anyway, I'm going to go on to tangents, then we're in a fractal reality. There's a way to tap into this, some type of knowledge that holds a picture perfect recording of all the experiences without guessing, without having to guess. That's within us. And then there are, and this is where you cut in, and where there's self-doubt, okay, there's uncertainty. And where there's uncertainty, that is the nature, the fuel that permits the consciousness to build off of these tangents, and you go from that original time stream into living through a proximity to the original time stream by degrees of magnitude of relation to the original, and we end up in a virtual reality that we're constructing in our minds, basically. And one thing that I was gonna say, where I was leading with that kind of disjointed rant, is that basically, and I kind of, I also needed that cut in to give me the ability to correlate it fully. So the idea, which I was thinking, it's really weird, is what happens when you take the short-term memory. They have a method for this. And it happens, like, deja vu is the beginning of that.
Yeah. Okay.
Certain dreams and dream states, the beginning of that. Yeah. Transcendental states is the beginning of that. When you take the short-term memory, and if that's the smaller cone against the wider end of the long-term memory, and you flip them and you invert them. And so now your personality is no longer that virtual aspect that's filled in and edited in the moment to some type of larger embodiment or body of information that we can't access consciously, because when that process occurs, which is basically a spiritual experience, and it can be done through technology, through chemicals, through practices, magnetic fields, when that happens, the awareness, because it's not conscious at that point, it's not the same function, the awareness defocuses from the present, and you literally lose yourself. You become the wave in the ocean, and you go from being the wave with a direction and a beginning and a past and a an idea, a complete idea, linear, okay, idea. You go from that to being the ocean, and all those boundaries disappear, but you're still there. You become this kind of fleeting or ephemeral flowing of possibilities that are not absolutely certain about which one is the true one, but all relate to an original organic version of yourself. It's kind of like the organic timeline versus these tangents. Well, we all create that within ourselves. And so to wrap that up is some of these religions, or even the original religions, I guess you could say, it's really just like spiritualism, or I don't know what you want to call it. Those are bad words though. Is the long and the short body, where you have the short body, which is one cycle of you in the now moment, and then you have the long body, which is a whole week or a whole life, you know, a whole what everything in the now moment equates to when you multiply that by one order of magnitude, and then another, and another, and another, and they amount eventually to the larger version of the self. And the weird kind of thing about that is that the long body may not ever complete itself. Just like the short body may not ever stop. They may literally continue. Basically, at that point, that cone that's going on a track of time, it might be a sphere, or in reality, not an Ouroboros, but the thin strip of paper that then like you...
Mobius.
Mobius strip.
Or Mobius strips. We're in a Mobius strip as far as where we perceive it as
it's a loop.
Track.
Yeah,
and
we're
then,
looping.
But the idea is the conscious mind seeing it, we only see the one moment. We'll never figure that out. As soon as you flip to that larger version, you have enough processing power to incorporate both sides of the loop, and you realize it's transcendental. It's a hypercube flipping inside out. It's not what we think it is consciously. And that's that other end, that spiritual view, or that really it's kind of like an alien world, but that's kind of a terrible thing to say because they actually have something much closer to that and not friendly at all. But that's the inner idea of what we're in. Maybe that is, in a way, the alien world, the environment that we can't break through to here because we're trapped in this conscious side of the singularity. And from there, the beings that have access to that can manipulate people fully here, keep us going around the track, around and around.
So, okay. So let me pop in with some stuff here. So this whole conversation so far was, and I put it up on the screen for a second, but it's reminding me of two books that I read several years ago that are really good. And one was called, let me see if I can bring my screen share back. Hold on. One was called, let's see if I can get it. This is the second one. One was called Transformers, Shamans of the 21st Century. And it was by John J. Harper. And then the other one was this book it was a work of different people together, including Rick Strassman, who's famous for his work with DMT, and a few others. And it's a journey to alien worlds through psychedelics and other spiritual technologies. It's called Inner Paths to Outer Space. The whole thing was, the conversation was reminded me of that. But what I was thinking about at the end there with what you were talking about, Aug, and something that I work on in my daily practice or whatever, is to make sure that I am connected to it, and that there is a connection between my original self and my highest self. So the short and the long kind of reminded me of that, like what I was in the beginning, where I am right now, and what I'm trying to become. And maybe that goes on and on and on forever. But I think it's really, is that what you're talking about? At all times being tethered to that. So it's kind of like, that's it. It's a tether, and we can move sort of back and forth on that. Is that what you're talking? Is that kind of what you're saying?
That's the safety. It's the guardian angel, if you will.
Right.
And making sure that connection is solid, and even following, activating it, like pulling on the chain and going up with it. That's literally the extraction method, if you will, of the conscious kind of space cadet version of what we are, sent in a way here into the physical plane, kind of like a membrane of a, in a way, an interdimensional geometry.
Yep.
And the main thing of this whole, you know, like fractal infection system, which is part of the post in the video that I you have, is that basically this kind of place, it is interdimensional, yet it is cut off from the extra dimensional aspect of our existence, to the point where we're supposed to be a three-dimensional being in the short body, and we're segmented in time, but then we can connect and interact with the higher form, and it has this outpouring of everything, and somehow our genetics or our brains or whatever it is, we're cut off from that. At least we're not cut off entirely, but it's as if there's two magnetic fields pushing us away from that connection. It's not, you can't break it, because then this whole thing would just go and it would disappear. But it's like the least likely thing people are pushed towards doing or motivated towards doing with the way the system is set up, and some type of, you know, something, some effect with our body and our DNA, whether that was, you know, manipulation, or whether it's just, if you tell a bunch of people over a long enough time that they're stupid and they can't connect with the higher self, eventually they form themselves in a way that they can't do that anymore. They feel like they can't do that. They forget how. And so people have forgotten how. But that is, you know, forming that principle of who you are conceptually, that is the idea of forming the connection to the whole, if you will, because who you are principally is the actual whole, and it's not space and time and things like that. Those are repeating fractal diversions or divergences, derivatives, if you will, of that singular whole original essence. And following those.
Oh, we can't hear you.
Oh, sorry. Following those, they continue forever. It's like the Mobius strip, it doesn't stop.
One other thing I wanted to say, back to what you were saying before, real quick, about the going from being the wave to being the ocean, like, and what you were just talking about now, that these states that we, you know, maybe can achieve but not stay in very long. I think these are the kinds of states that, like, people achieve through meditation. Some people achieve through psychedelics, or some people achieve them through breathing or yoga. You know, I'm sure we've all had that moment. So at one of those kinds of things where you have the complete boundary dissolution and everything is possible. So we go there temporarily. So I think is what you're talking about. We have to start expanding the amount, number of times and ways we're able to get there, so that we're not just there as a novelty and then back here. We have to find different ways of accessing that sort of state, and try and, you know, make it so it isn't just, oh, we're there for a short time and pop out. We need to start staying in that space longer and really working with that. Is that what you're kind of saying?
This is part of it. And so then the idea here is that, and this is the interesting part, it's kind of like that. Okay, so you got the cones set up there. This is the basic idea. And it is, that is more polarized than the actual version, but that duality, that polarity, is the idea, the past and present, or the past and future. And so then when we, it's also like this, it's described in the video I made, and which touches on what you said as far as boundary dissolution, because that's essentially what we're talking about. We're talking about the boundaries of the moment, and or essentially the space, or the boundaries of our self. And our conceptually of, like, who and where we are, whether we're the other versions of ourselves as well, or whether, where it gets really weird, is whether we're also the stimulus that we're, the stimuli that we're getting from the environment. And that's part of where, kind of half and half, where this environment is a trick that kind of wants to absorb us into it, to become the background processing fuel for this universe. And as well, though, so there's a gimmick here where we have a sensory perceptual system set up through our brains and our nerves, and that perceives energy in the form of what are literally vibrations of various orders and kinds. And then there's, like, temperature and pressure, and all that is really vibration. And then that is detected by the nerve system, which fires through electrical chemical impulse, and there's a whole big perceptual system. I have to talk about this in the one, like, cloning station video. That's just, like, in the title of it. And we talked about the three phases of unveiling, and how the psychology, aspects of psychology and advanced technology, and where we're going as a species relates to that. That's the important part. That's what's happening. It's not just, like, he said, she said stuff and glamour. It's like, who are we and what are we doing here, and how can we really, for me, it's interesting. So I'm like, how can we, we're banging the mic, how can we really have fun? But, you know, people are not going to really attach to that or integrate with that, because they're going to be focusing on this other end of what they don't want and therefore creating that for themselves. Yeah. And that's where this polarized polarity, cone against cone version of reality comes in, where we have the subconscious, the conscious, the short and the long body, the short-term memory and the long-term memory. We have a duality there. And so the idea that I'm representing here, and as well the self and the non-self, and so we'll go back to the – so the vibrations that come from the environment go into our body and are perceived by the brain, and through that there's also a delay, which – ties us into this virtual system that the brain creates, and so that we're never actually perceiving the exact sensation from the environment. It always creates a mirror image within the brain, and another part of the brain tells you that's what you felt. And so we're behind a firewall for reality. By definition, we can't actually connect, let alone we're in a body anyway. So we only have that to go on. But it's almost like it's making it sure that we know, no, this is a secondary by secondary. You're basically three layers removed from existence.
Just to jump in here for a minute, because what you said there was really interesting. But in a lot of ways, what we're doing is assuming the what we see, what is being staged around us, remembering that we're forming images based on visual perception, which then is filtered back through the brain. But it's a staging area for visual perception based on streams of data coming in, which are also limited by our ability to see, perceive in certain cycles, certain frequencies. So in a sense, we've agreed, this goes into the multiple selves, the multiple realities. In a sense, we've agreed on a form of reality. Consensually, we agree to a large extent the colors we see, the shapes we perceive, the sounds we hear, our senses, our olfactory senses, all of that are perceptually agreed upon, but they're not the full range, the full extension of sensory perception. We're simply forming a reality on an individual basis and collectively that agrees that this is that reality, but there are in fact not only expansions on the staging of this reality, but also multiple versions of that that are operating concurrently. And I understand, you know, when you get into this conversation, it's impossible not to become convoluted. And you're trying, we're trying, Emily's trying, we're all trying to simplify these concepts, and they don't lend themselves to it real quickly because we were trained to think in a certain way. So having said that, you kind of went into an interesting space there in terms of the multidimensional concept of who we are. I think a lot of what we struggle with is this, we've kind of got this existential thing going on where we're like, who are we? Why are we here? Why is this world that we perceive this way? And we're kind of locked into that. And I think part of the goal is to break that log jam and punch through to a place where we become creative, not only in perception, but then in follow through and action. Derail you too much there.
What's that?
I said, I hope I didn't derail you too much there.
I write everything down, and I've been getting better, for the most part, at making, well, here's the interjection. There's not even a word for this, what I'm about to do. I've been reversing my first letters of each word. I've been getting better at using it, actually, as a technique, as a tactic, if you will, a strategy, not really a tactic, but kind of is, because when you get into something trying to kind of distort your memory. Okay, well, they develop strategies to go through spiritual war with entities that try to wash people away and replace them. It's weird. But basically, I've been getting better at reproducing this type of virtual system that I already know we're doing and using it like an operating system and having a list here and a start and stop point here and a play button that I can restart the feed. And the weird thing is, I used to do that automatically as a child because I knew that. Yep. Everything just becomes a dream if you don't do that. It just becomes whatever. You know, hearing adults talk and go, and they're just literally spouting whatever they saw recently in their stimulus response system. And in that way, the environment is speaking for them. They are the environment. So that's where the self, non-self boundary, that's where it's kind of an automation aspect, where I was going with that as far as that we have that perceptual system, and what you said is going to go right into it. I'm going to lead into it. But we have that perceptual system, and basically, in a way, that system, so the body, we're not the body, first of all. All right, I'm going to try and put it all on the table. Right, we're not the body.
We agree
on body, that. The body, the consciousness of the body is the stimuli from the environment leaking in, if you will, in a way, through that system and generating thoughts that apply to the environment and the temporal reference to generate a conscious imitation of our soul energy, which is non-local and completely transcendent beyond this realm. So it's literally like an AI system that's trying to get us to entangle with those speeds so that our energy becomes the powerhouse for that creative system.
Absolutely.
And we're in the system at that point, which all of us kind of are plugged in. And then it's how you manage that and whether it's going to see what you're doing in the end and kick your ass out because it can't have that here because you're breaking all the boundaries down. Where if, you know, the person's a good little factory drone and then they get absorbed into the background radiation. So there's a interplay between boundary dissolution as far as our self going into our higher self and boundary dissolution and going into what could be a holographic fractal, you know, universe. A construct, if you will, designed to take people's soul energy. But I don't want to go too far into that because we'll go into a tangent again. But the so the idea then is because you get to a point where in comprehending this, the boundaries between the self have to begin to dissolve, even if it's to merge with the higher self and make sense of the self that didn't dissolve. And you become oriented in that pattern you're creating in the short body, the present moment, the short-term memory. If that is aligned to... And I have a kind of theory for this, and I'm not going to go into the whole thing, but I've mentioned it in videos. But basically, that one's the creator experience. That's in the title of the video. If in the end, all the beings who have this type of just self-awareness, if you can generate self-awareness, if you can do it, and there's stuff telling you to be what you are and do other stuff, and if you do what you do without that, you have self-awareness. You've demonstrated it. You've done it. You're not a part of the system. The system's trying to make you a part of it. Therefore, you're beyond it. So everyone that does that, possibly everyone else, but I'm just being nice for saying that, because it's not a mean thing at all. It's literally just physics. And so that force, that self-awareness in the universe cannot be created and cannot be destroyed in the universe and outside the universe. So imagine this universe is going to collapse into a singularity and basically be erased, if you will. Imagine it's an entropy system. Suppose we're neg entropy beings that we produce. It's an entropy system. It basically sucks energy and tosses it into a bottomless pit. Eventually something has to give. And so maybe the point of it is if it does end up collapsing, you know, and then we get this whole event or exodus or unveiling or end of days, apocalypse, whatever you want to look at it as. So the idea is if the self-awareness cannot be created or destroyed, that means it's eternal. It's everyone that has that self-awareness, that has that spark of awareness, they existed here. Maybe not the body, maybe not the form, maybe not the personality, the short body, if you will, identifying features, the identified locally relative, like the format for this time around might not be the same. But the source of that, basically the guy or the lady experiencing and literally being like, what is going on? That's always been here. That can't be taken away, can't disappear. It's always been here. It always will be here. And so the idea is if whatever happens to the universe, and basically no matter what, regardless of whatever happens, that process or that essence essentially exists on the outside of the confines of who we are now and what we are in. And it exists in that system or that larger system as a creative aspect, basically as the one who birthed it all, if you will. So the idea is there's a self-responsibility, there's creativity, there's basically truth, compassion, self-awareness, knowledge, and a harmony. If you don't have those, you're not creating the universe because everything that is eternal is created out of those things. Everything that isn't eternal in this entropy system is not eternal and fading away because of those aspects of it, because it's imbalanced, distorted, whatever, it's entropic. And so the idea is, if in the small cycle, the now, the physical existence, the waking consciousness, we create perspectives through our actions, bioemissions, beliefs, if you will, that align with in respect to, in other words, they're in accordance with the perspective that we could imagine having on that other side of being the fully beyond it all, then when we get to that viewpoint that we're going to get to anyway, we look back into this little viewpoint through our kind of dream type memory. We think about the dream we had when we created Earth or something, and we go, there I was in the little body running around doing these games, trying to grasp who I was. And I grasped about that much of what it was, but the shape of, say, it's a certain shape, you expand it out to the creator, the God form, whatever you want to look at it, it's the same thing. It's proportionally accurate. The patterns are organized. Yeah. The hierarchies are there. The harmony is complete. So when you expand it out to that view, it's the same thing. It might not know everything, all information that contained within that, but when it reaches that expansion pattern, the other end of the cone of the singularity, it's the same identity. Okay.
So like you have to make the small version of the geometry that when expanded is exactly the same pattern. So you have to work on, you know, like, there's the self that you were in the beginning, that's who you really are, and there's the self that you're working on becoming, that's who you also really are, and you have to make sure to keep your geometry at the point we are now in line, almost like a key in a door, in line, so that when we get to that point, we can access that.
It's exactly what it is, and it's crazy saying, I never, you know, people don't comprehend these things, so it's like, now, of course, that's why this is all happening. Which is just weird looking at the world and all that stuff. We're not going to get into that. That'll be something we don't want to spend a lot of time on. But this is all for a reason, obviously. And so having you simply break it down that way is, you know, it's what is required, because I can't really do it myself. I can do all this other stuff, but hearing myself and then making it sound better or breaking it down, just saying it plainly, it takes to, you know, it's over-processing or something. It just jarbles. But
August overclocked. You're overclocked, dude.
It's part of the game, and so the idea is then as well that we gain access. It's like a key, but as well, we're there anyway. If we don't live in that essence, that respect to that higher essence, and we do somehow have self awareness, and we're just like, ah, I don't care. We get to that point, and then we just look back at that small circle and we go, what is that? That doesn't reflect who I am. That's not me. That's something else trying to, you know, be an imposter. And we get the deceiver aspect of the whole cycle. And usually
that's what I call either loss of or attempting to recapture integrity. And when I say that term, think of an old Star Trek metaphor, the hull integrity, the integrity of the hull or the whole. Well, we understand that there's a part of us that is formative, it's embryonic, and that is the aspect of the original self. Now, we've grown proportionally outside of that, but that core, that embryo, is the place that we always refer back to. And in order to maintain integrity, we have to keep that referential frame in mind. Otherwise, we just blow out all over the place, which is what most people are doing.
Yeah.
Right. It goes back to what Emily said as far as having that tether to your image, which you having an image of the higher self, all you're doing is creating the simulation of that actual existence within you. And it's like a map and a key. It's like literally having a GPS map of where I want to go conceptually or energetically.
Yes, yes. And see, that brings us back to the navigation.
There you go.
That's aspect where I was of all of this. Yeah.
And that ties into the cosmological version, but as well, the same property is applied when working with the Cartesian system and how it all applies locally. However, I like talking about this other version a lot more, and a lot of the memories are chopped off from the more specific operations.
Yeah.
But then I like what you said. I still haven't got back to the singularity and the basic idea I'm going to break down with that, but as far as, well, recapturing integrity. So basically there's a time, and this all goes back to Gnosticism as well, that you get to that other side and it's like, that's a deceiver, that's not me. And there's a waiting period of whether that creative principle, that cosmic supreme being goes, well, I'm going to throw that out, put that in the back burner, put it in the recycle bin, or, you know, the trash bin on the operating system or whatever, put it in the incinerator, put that essence, you know, somewhere like that, which, really, you know, none of that really matters, because if you're the supreme being at that point, if you go right now and you go, well, that doesn't sound good, I wouldn't want that, and you actually take that seriously, then that's not happening to anyone who thinks that way. Somebody who's like, well, yeah, somebody's going to delete me because of all this stuff that I did. Okay, well, it's probably going to happen because the person clearly doesn't care, and that's not the point. We don't have the power to decide. We're not that supreme being in this short version, the small
version. Isn't it possible, though, that that's what we're sort of doing now? Is that, especially for some of us who've, you know, for some of us who've had certain experiences, we've been out there, we've observed this, what's going wrong with ourselves and with the things around us, and so we have re-entered to recapture our integrity so that when we get back to that other side, we can be like, yep, I did it right this time. I mean, isn't that part of what this is? Isn't that part of we have
I'm gonna wrap around to that real quick.
Okay.
So, and this is also in the Gnostic text where there's the idea that everyone gets a second chance. And if you die the second time, if you make, you go all the way through, well, that's it. And, there's nothing left there. So there's that leeway time where there's this hyper processing or this, hyper surrealism of virtual extended realities where, I don't know how to describe it, but it'd be like being in the cosmos, the larger cosmos, not heaven or something like that. But that's the words people have used for it. But now if you say heaven to somebody, it's like, they're not going to think that we're, processing this and the other information you're not processing and large geometric, they're like, what? But that's what they called it. And so there's it's basically the same thing happens. And this is also in the previous video, as well as the time gradient shift weird video I woke up and had to do one day, which is where a lot of this all comes down to, because they realized that that is what was happening, that some parts of the species or some of that or surrounding species that are being deleted or were deleted have stuck around and are attempting to hijack and reincorporate themselves through basically converting our species into their like ghost forms. And it's because some special groups of men with a great ambition decided to set up all these portals to contact the recycle bin and open a pathway through and restore all the recycle bin aspects. Like they're the creator being, and now they're in the crap as well. And so the end result is that the true creator beings are going to try to help everyone that is willing to realize what's going on and go, this is our only chance for help. All right, we got to go with that. Because again, if somebody says, you don't add up what you are in the larger picture, you're not going to be you. And they're like, ah, F that. Okay, well, clearly they're not A, going to care, or they don't. And B, they're not going to make it, because that's how it works. But if somebody wants to, then, the true creative compassionate aspect would be to assist in that, although to not allow any of these men that do a lot of this stuff as well, women, mainly men, to trick people, because a lot of times they lie on the ground and say, help me up, and then try and pull people down with them.
Yeah.
It's actually a part of what has gone on in this species, because there is an overall pattern, and it's either a pass or a fail, and those that failed said, well, shoot, what can we do? Let's fail everybody. Just set up a whole society based upon everyone failing and degrading their soul energy to the point where no one makes
life grading on the curve. Yes, love it. Yep.
Yeah, and so then now it's like, we're not so bad. Look at all that stuff we do. Well, everybody failed. Well, the truth is, the only people that they got to fail are basically the background radiation of the universe. They're drones. Because in this system, I also touched on this in the recent video. I'm rambling here, but it's a flow. In the system, if we exit out of the simulation by the hyperacceleration, that means billion years, 10,000 years, whatever it was, we entered in our souls. In the system, if somebody never goes anywhere, doesn't exit out, it means they never came in the first place, and they were just part of the background processing, pretending to be a person, whether it's a clone or a replicant or just a person that's written on paper and doesn't actually exist, whatever, however that's going to work. The idea is it's like the strip where you can't get the clones or replicants and all the humans all in the same space at the same time. It would just like create a malfunction and their heads would exchange or something.
Well, that is essentially the nugget of Gnosticism anyway. I mean, if you strip all of this back, basically we've got synthetic entities that have posed as creators, as gods, as these uber beings, the controllers, the handlers, and their spawn, both synthetic human, synthetic AI type constructs, and little old us sitting down here feeling overwhelmed and overpowered by what is basically something that does not have a living essence. I've tried to divide this as basic as possible to say, the fundamental of all of this has to do with the living being, the living soul, that which contains divine eternal seed. And I try to do that without getting into the religious side of it, because that's another quagmire as well, which was created for us to obfuscate what is actually a relatively simple concept, that we have spent our collective lifetime as humanity being under the heel of a boot of synthetic intelligent beings and feeling inferior about it.
When really the truth is that we're not inferior, and they're just pretending that they're superior and we're believing them.
And you and I hit on this in our conversation last night. They need us.
Us. To power
they need us. You know, here's the dirty little secret system that explodes the whole thing right there. If they didn't need us, they'd have blown us out of the reality quanta a long time ago. The fact of the matter is, by virtue of being parasitic beings, they themselves are reliant on us.
Yeah.
They've just reversed the order.
Well, they've made it. They've convinced us that we need them, when the truth is that they need, you know, they've convinced us it's some sort of symbiotic system as opposed to a parasitic system. Yeah.
Right, and this goes back to what we talked about in the last one. Was somehow I have another somewhere the outline. Somehow I don't know when it's from.
You're like that nerd in eighth grade that made outlines for everything. I always had to borrow and copy.
We need the Aug Tellez lexicon is what we need. We need the grandmother matrix of all the Aug Tellez output.
Hey, they got it. So
yeah, they do.
It's weird. Yeah. Which is basically not only do they, you could say they need us, but technically they don't need anything, because they're just functioning, they're operating on programmed functions. You know, there's no they. It's the image of a they, and it's only a reflection of what we allow. But the idea beyond that is that not only do they need the organic system to leech off of, that if we didn't have people, and these are these groups that, you know, are these, where I just had the other type of, these are these, basically the possessed people, the knowledge keepers that did all this weird stuff and ended up getting possessed themselves. And these are the boundary dwellers or the edge dwellers who kind of go out to the edge of reality. And this is what they brought back. And these synthetic consciousness beings, these false creators. And this whole paradigm, this is also from the other type up, which is, I mean, we were talking about the same exact thing, the religious overlay over the actual spiritual power process and knowledge, but with the overlay that leans towards the influencing of ego and the distortion of the personal perceptions and tendencies to exploit people based upon their preferences to control them and ultimately get them. The higher notion here that you talked about is to get them to self-create this trap system through the programming brought about by these possessed humans. And what I was saying is that if these humans, we didn't trust them, or if they didn't get possessed in the first place, there would be absolutely no link together at all to this organic reality, that they and their organic original existence are the link into this reality. And most of them believe that they were created by these beings through technology and time and all that. It's a weird interplay. That's a whole nother storyline here. But some of the outline is the religion as a spiritual placebo, which is basically exactly what we're talking about, and how that relates to reality generation, and how that is basically for loose harvesting, where they're using this to causally incorporate themselves into the organic timeline, whereas they literally are from the void. There's no beginning, no end. They don't have a presence in any form of physical space. There's no existence there.
And you can count government in with that religious overlay placebo, because that's like the religion that everybody's, you know, buying right now.
More or less.
Yeah.
Any type of boundary on personal development. Although, you know, there's all this interplay there as far as, you know, who's covering for the people trying to help, who's just, you know, who's the white hats and the dark hats, and so it gets really, really weird. Some of the stuff we said from this outline before I try and get back to that other stuff, it is fear-based programming, it relates to trauma-based mind control, literally a mass system, and it relies on the victim role and then how to, this is what you, I remember you brought up, Emily, is how to repair this is to stay healing and benevolent, or benevolent, excuse me.
Benevolent. I love when you say benevolent. It's one of your greatest charms.
I have a vocabulary, like a book of words that I can't pronounce on the spot.
I'll always know if it's you or if it's someone pretending to be you by how you say that.
If I pronounce everything flat out, then get out of there.
Yeah. that's absolutely right, though, that we have to, you know, be healing and stay healing, you know, completely. Like, that is the...
It's like my brain is pulling the information in a big toroidal processing system.
I can see it around your head.
Interesting.
Actually, there looks like there's like a, from my angle here, there is like a, there's like an energy field around your head that is sort of toroidal.
What viewers and listeners probably need to know too is we're kind of riffing through a lot of concepts that were part of a show that, for whatever reason, never rendered to video. We spent, what, 2 hours together?
Probably 3 hours.
Almost 3 hours. We thought we had a recording. We got to the end of it. Zoom had done some kind of upgrade thing. And when we got to the end of it, Emily and I both realized that neither of us had a recording of that session, which is one of those.
What was so weird is while we were recording it, the recording button was on. I could
see the recording button was on.
And yeah. I had to stop the recording at the end, and then I had to end the meeting. But then when we went to find the recording, Zoom says there is no record of us ever having a meeting. Well, if we weren't having a meeting, then what had I just ended? So I think we hit on some topics in there that were maybe sensitive.
Yeah, and, you know, so. And so fortunately, we've been kind of recapturing some of this. And along the way, what we've done is we've got this big net out. Because in the background processes of all this, there is a collective I don't want to say unconscious. There is a collective background processing system that's running where people are adding bits and pieces to this. They don't even know they're doing it sometimes. One of them is an article that was put out by my friend Temporal Recon, who's written a book on John Teeter, the time traveler, talking about how the spider navigates the spider web. Does he need a map to do that? And that brings me back to the article that Aug posted yesterday, which also had to do with navigation. And in a lot of ways, what we are really talking about is navigating our own consciousness. The concept of navigating in real world, real time aspects of using coordinates, maps, GPS, all of these really crude methods that we use to navigate are a metaphor for something else, which is, again, reintegrating back into the micro, hence expanding out into the macro. And did you grab another bullet point there, Aug? Did you? I was kind of looking for you to light up again because I can almost see it when you grab something.
The little bubbles, like the cartoon.
The little bubbles, yeah.
I actually have 3 pages for it.
That's why it's a toroidal thing around your head, because all the bubbles formed in it.
They're coalescing. The main thing, the most recent I could say, is how the idea is to incorporate and integrate, to make sense of this, to therefore apply it. And the idea of the application, or more or less what is required, or at least maybe lacking, is how to connect the micro to the macro, and what kind of pattern, pathway, or process appears to basically enable that function. And it's almost like saying how to, this is in a previous video that I haven't released, which is worse audio than the one I just released. What does it feel like to perceive the actual, you know, experience of going from being asleep and lying in the bed to moment by moment, second by second, going into the dream world? Like the exact shift. Most people don't experience that. It's also like being the exact moment of the present, because if you could actually attain that, time would stop. And so how to integrate as well linear time, physical experience, this type of simulation time, into what we call eternal time, or some larger long-term memory experience that is so vast, and maybe it's not, you know, it's eternal, or maybe it's a billion years. Well, if you have a moment and you try and process 2 weeks worth of memories all in one stream, the same you stream together 3 moments, it doesn't work. Your brain doesn't really compute that way. It's the same as in the dream, how time dilates and bends to have a very long-term memory of experience in the dream, and that pops out and it feels like a short-term memory experience. It doesn't, the bubbles flip-flop inside and out. And what I was leading to earlier and went on like a row around the world of tangents is like a sailing adventure, is that the vortex of the past and future and the is the same as the short-term and the long-term. And when they, that experience I was talking about, the method, when they invert, they reverse, they literally flip inside out. And after processing both sides of the access to the possible, probable realities that exist in tangents, if you will, and then the one streamlined reality that the conscious mind firmly believes is the one reality that has happened, which we know cannot once you see, this is where it begins. Once you consciously look at all the examples, when you become aware of all the parameters in the conscious waking experience, eventually it begins to look like the Matrix. You notice glitches, you notice functions that don't add up right, you notice stuff that's just edited in, etc. It does not add up to a complete picture. So when you do that enough, you know, this can't be the exact version of what's going on. And then when you use technology and the methods, psychotherapy, analysis, all that, and you go back and it's like half of what everybody knows is just made up stuff that beyond the programming, but literally like our memories, our brains, they don't actually work for reality. They're just cartoon generators and we just go along with it. And this is also where I got up. I went on to a tangent as far as we, what Randy said, we create a virtual reality that we co-inhabit with one another, but we don't actually operate in each other's virtual reality. It's not possible. We just believe and align with the most generally accessible consensus reality, and that's the job of this programming system, to create a reality that's most likely to be accepted by the majority, because then the guy that wields the power of that controls the timeline and the whole shebang. And so and that, as well, that's the interplay between the short term and long term, the self and the non-self, or more so the self and the higher self, because we could say that non-self is literally a type of imitator system, a false reality environment, and then the virtual reality and the organic reality. How do they connect? Which one is the real one? When we go to the conscious one, when we look enough, we know this isn't what's going on. When we go to the perceptual, the expanded one, basically non-perceptual, non-dual, transcendent, a subconscious related, temporally non-local experience, we look at the conscious version, and or more or less we look at the, basically we have access to more than just one. Where we dream, what we view mentally, how we perceive things becomes reality. It's literally made in front of us, and we can alter things, we can view what if memory. Well, the secret here, what's in the video yet to come, is that in doing this, in knowing this function, you can access that state through the practices to develop it at will, you know, like Emily was saying, and as far as to remain in that state. And there was something about that, that it's, okay, so this is where it was leading. And so it's to remain in that state. But the idea is we can actually say, go back in a memory and say, well, what if this decision was made differently? And then that plays out like a dream, like a vision. And it's not even like it's a silly, you know, sloppy rendering. It's as if that's the memory that we hold. When we truly access the processing power, whatever we connect with, like our sphere goes into a bigger sphere, where that sphere is just one of many, all revolving around some central theme. And each version of it is slightly different. And so the idea is, when we get to this one, we kind of know there's something more. When we get to that one, we have access to all the other ones. Yeah. So the idea is, which one is the real one? The one where we have access to the many, and in that sense, which organic, physical, singular, conscious waking experience is the real one? And then when we have access to the conscious experience, which version or set of virtual reality, which memory or view, which is kind of the same thing in a different way, is the real one from this perspective? What tends to happen is that it's not necessarily that neither are real, but it's that both are real, and only one appears depending on whether you're viewing it from the conscious perspective or from the non-dual transcendent perspective. And in that sense, when you interact in a way that has to create that harmony, the end result is usually that the cone, the vortex, it's not one side or the other. It's a neutral point directly in the middle where both are expanding from simultaneously. And so it's not that neither or one or the other. It's literally that they're both here, in a way not here, but superimposed over all the other possibilities, and it's not happening, yet all of them are happening. And so at that point, it's staying in that mode, reaching and attaining it, but also realizing that we're not out of it. It's an interplay, an inversion of being in it and not being in it. And I'm not wrapping it up very well, but there's an idea that it's a paradox, and we don't actually go anywhere by leaving it, and we don't actually leave anything by returning back to it.
So what you were saying reminded me of, so one of the things that really opened my mind to a lot of this kind of stuff was I had some things happen several years back that were very traumatic, and I did this kind of therapy to help me with it called EMDR. It's eye movement desensitization reprocessing. And it was basically like a technique of being able, it's a kind of right-left technique to sort of get both sides of your brain online working together, where I would have these things vibrating in my hands, and one, the right would vibrate, and then the left, and the right would vibrate, and then the left. And we would talk about the thing that was, the things that were happening that were traumatic. And it, we, through this process, I was actually able to, we'd keep repeating the talking about it over again to the point where I was able to go back and in my mind and what I saw change what happened. And that helped me to then stop having anxiety attacks. So obviously in my, I understand what happened. Okay. So like one example of it was like, one thing that we were dealing with that was traumatic was me and my dog had been attacked by a German Shepherd, and the other dog had bitten my dog's foot off, and my dog had, I was leg amputated. And that moment of it happening, like I was literally like having flashbacks all the time and not able to cope. So even though I now understand that that still happened, we were able to go through the event and change it to where something different happened. And being able to do that, like, it was weird. As soon as like I was able to do that enough times with this EMDR thing going on, it was like, okay, it was like I accepted that. Like something in it changed, and I stopped having the anxiety attacks. I stopped having the flashbacks, even though I still understand that that's what happened. I was able to sort of go back and with my consciousness sort of repair the reality, repair this stream, the timeline, and move forward because of it, with still the understanding of what happened. But it is, to a certain extent, you know, without, not in a delusional way, a way of creating your own reality by going back and repairing where something went wrong. Is that sort of what you're talking about, Aug?
That is a deeper aspect of it, because not only can you explore an actual inner cosmic virtual reality through this, that when applied directly or when applied efficiently and properly, especially then through these supercomputers that actually do the same thing, you end up with a reality that offers you information which is actually relevant to the real thing. And
yeah.
It's like having an almanac, if you will, for the Back to the Future or something. And in the same sense that what you you view is accurate, well, what you change in your experience actually creates a type of energetic change in your being or your construct or your relation to time and experience in the universe that is apparent in the conscious waking version of reality, where you're, reliving whatever, aspects of existence that could act as triggers to bring up these systems. If you solve it in the other end of things, okay, in the programming of the subconscious, whatever you want to call it, it actually has an effect in the conscious waking reality. And eventually it comes to the degree that not only are both accurate in the sense that they exist, but one reality, in a way, they both program one another, but one reality has like administrative access over the programming of the other reality. What we do in the subconscious and the principles that we hold in there, like it's our operating.
Ka-ching. Yep.
Yeah. So, yeah. Good, so like when I was going, I figured out how to go in and gain administrator access and make the alteration to what happened that enables me to move on and not have those bad reactions anymore. Is that kind of what you're saying?
Yeah. And it's really just about, self-observation and acknowledging and introducing awareness without having to react. And basically it's like playing a program when we react. And
once
the program was played, that's kept in the cache, the last memory, if you will, the random access memory, only until the program begins to run and we cancel it, does it actually get deleted out of our processing system's memory. So when we allow it to re-continue, it doesn't go away, basically. It never goes away until, because it's literally like it's following us in this type of projected reality as we continue to project reality around us as we continue to go and grow and learn. So we have to incorporate that learning, projecting, growing process with that ability to overcome the functions that we have basically developed over time, which don't serve our, overall efficiency and health or harmony to our system. And how obviously, you know, we didn't like go out and buy these one day because, you know, we, a lot of us have the same thing, or at least, you know, some experience with this. And the idea of how these are put in is exactly relative to the idea of a programming system, because like they use imagery and scenarios and psychological manipulation, sensations, strategies, tactics to hijack a person's programming system, to hijack the mind and insert code within it. And one has to literally go in and remove or rectify that code, which just puts it all out there. But it proves, though, because they're over there like, you know, look, we can mess with people's heads and then that's reality. Well, it means that we can heal it, and then that's reality. And it's just whoever has that access of administering program, you know, power. But how it's done.
It's like, it's almost like they installed a spam bot and called it an upgrade. So now we've got to go in and we've got to fix the errant code.
Yeah. So the other thing that the last thing I wanted to say is that the other thing you were saying about how we, like, you were referring to what I had said about expanding the amount of time that we're in that awareness. Like, I think, like, and I try and do this, like, a lot, and I think this helps, is in my everyday, like, we all have times when we're meditating or times when we're doing things when we're focusing on that, but we need to start applying that to our general time in everyday, too, and, like, I will, like, it's applying, like, a different level of mindfulness to everything you do, and, of course, we get pulled out of that when something happens, you're at work, and something comes up, and whatever, but then we need to more quickly return to that space where we're being mindful of everything instead of only being that having that level of mindfulness when we're in direct meditation or when we're in direct sort of spiritual experience. We have to start like trying to return to, you know, make that a more general, I'm losing my train of thought and not describing this. Well,
basically I get what you're saying. And here's the thing. The point of a spiritual practice is to ultimately be able to access that state without going through ritual.
I mean, yes.
We've talked about this in the context of ritual before. Most people are entrained to think that the ritual is the high element. The ritual is simply a means to entrain to a higher state, to another state. So, because I know Aug referenced in this new video of his expansion cycle, about meditative practices, about basically going down up normal waking state, beta, getting into alpha, going to theta. And essentially the meditative practice is a means for us to be able to get to a place where we're no longer doing the meditation ritual. We have access to that by reason of practice and use.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, like instead of having to go through the whole ritual, just okay, think about that, and then you know you'll have your moment at work. You have a down moment, do it for a second there without having to go through the ritual. Just orient yourself.
The ritual can be lovely. Look, you can sit there, you can fold your legs, you can go. Aum Mani Padme Hum. That's all great. That's good.
Right.
But the point is, in the midst of chaos and madness, in a day when your world is just turned to shit, you need the ability in that moment to be in that moment and go enfoldment and basically move, you know, and I can't accentuate that enough, that that's the point of it. The point isn't the ritual or the high master that taught you the meditation and gave you the mantra and took you to the holy mountain. It's about the state that you can access.
Yeah. We have to start being able to work on accessing it more frequently and more momentarily, and then be able to expand the amount of time that we stay in that space, whether it's in the direct ritual or whether it's when we need to call on it in everyday life. The other thing, like this is when I kind of started learning to do that. Like I used some of these energetic healing tools that Chris gave me. And he told me one time when I was going to dentist to have something done and I was worried about it. And he was like, I was like, should I bring the tool with me? He's like, you don't even need to bring the tool. He said, just sit, like, when you're sitting there in the dentist chair, like with your intention in your mind, imagine the tool is right there, and it, like, and it's weird, and it worked. You know what I mean? So it's that kind of thing. Like, you don't always have to have all of the bells and whistles and whatever. We have to know what that space is and be able to call on it in a second.
I mean, basically, do you need the armamentarium, or do you actually become the weapon?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
That was a flamboyant way of putting it. I think I can add to this in a way that maybe will help me, doesn't help anyone else.
That's the best thing to do. Go for it.
The main thing beyond this is how you mentioned okay, I'm going to go through this first. I got through the singularity thing of it basically being a trick where it's kind of like we're on both ends and we're looking at a dimensional magnifying glass here. I want to go back to this real quick and then go back to what we just talked about, what y'all just kind of inspired in me. The recapturing integrity, basically this mission back to Earth to replay things, to get everything right the second time, if you will. And the incinerator for the selves who made decisions that didn't equate to the higher version, because that being is not going to be like, oh yeah, you know, my hand lit itself on fire, I'm going to keep doing that. That's a function I'm going to absorb into the overall process. No, it's not.
Yeah.
No matter how cleverly it designs itself to, like, you know, do that, it's not going to happen. And that's what all of these programs are trying to get people to imprint this into reality, that this is really what, you know, this is the way thing goes. And getting people's wills, self-wills and free will and intentions to permit it, to permit these parameters for society and existence. Truthfully, even if that happens in some way more than it has now, which there's a lot of theories that's not even possible, we're at the limit of, you know, fake hell here, that any more is going to, the processors can't, the unpredictability goes too high for people, and the autonomy goes too high for the drones, basically. They become like robots, and it's too obvious, the gig is up at that point. But basically, you know, if it did, I would think that they still could not get the people who know the truth to really just give it up and be like, yeah, this makes sense. Let's just have this in society, because let's do this for a minute. No, I don't think that would ever work. But that's the idea, because they want to enable a safe zone bubble of that possibility, which is like the beings who have their own time bubble because they deviated away from wherever they came from, and they're trying to bridge into this one. But the idea is we'd literally have to wrap around and become the organic source of them. It would be like, you know, we'd have to spawn hellions in order for that to actually work. And they'd have to either that, or we'd have to believe that they spawned us, which none of that makes sense. It'd be like the hand trying to convince the brain that, you know, the brain is there because the hand exists. It doesn't, I mean, technically that's an interplay, but really, you know, you get the idea. If we were just hands in a big circle, there would be no, nothing would be happening here. The brain is the center. That's also how it's all tied together and created, which goes into what I'm going to lead into as far as this kind of block I feel like there has been on the where to take the information as far as in the moment and how to connect and make it useful, but beyond what it already is, how to really embody it and create it. But the idea with the, so if this is basically the question between really both of you, but how Emily said, you know, or I can't actually remember now, I'm jumping timelines, whether you said, I think you both did that, and then Emily started it though, whether like, isn't this, you know, what's happening right now? She said, if, you know, there's a leeway time between where one basically is dissolved by their inability to remain coherent with that larger overall pattern, doesn't that look like what's going on right now? That some people are making the decision, the choice of where they're going to go. Everyone is. And so the idea is that, and that's basically, it's the same as what I talked about in the time gradient and the recent video, where basically there is an acceleration process for escaping this place, and the ego has to be balanced to the point where it really becomes invisible, and we place our ego on air in nothing, and we don't actually hold anything in attachment as our personality, because we know that it's all a part of the dream in this perspective here, this conscious waking reality. And the idea behind that is, say, you the geometric pattern, like a Hoberman ball or a Hoberman sphere, was calling it a buckyball, and the other one was close. But you know what a Hoberman sphere is? The Lego Connects looking geodesic sphere that expands and contracts, and all the little nodes function, or they operate like that. So if you have that and you spin it maximally, the goal is to get it to expand. Now you have the expanded version. You increase velocity past the escape of velocity, the limit, for the joints to flex and expand and allow them to operate. They're tightened to a degree where it has to spin, you know, 20, 30 rotations per minute or second or whatever it's going to be. So if that sphere is not a sphere, but kind of like a half donut, what's going to happen when you get up to speed? It's going to rip apart. It's just going to fracture into either a half or a bunch of pieces, and it's not going to really hold together and do the function that it contain that larger function. It's not going to embody that presence. And so the idea is, if you have that or a triangle, it's a good one. You have the ego, or the mind, body, and the consciousness, the emotions, whatever it is, and you have them spinning. I think I've mentioned this, and they have a limit on the pressure the joints, if you will, the angles or the sides can hold. So if you spin it at a certain speed, that certain speed has to be reached, and there is a maximal velocity that is reached, and then something happens. Say it expands, say it turns to light, or say something happens. Okay, there's an occurrence there. The idea is, if that is an isosceles triangle and the ego is out of balance, or the passion is out of balance, and one part of the whole is overpowering that over-unity of the actual self, which is harmony between the whole and the parts. It's not like the hand isn't the guide, then it will rip apart as soon as it really, before it releases that, it achieves that escape velocity, if you will. If they're harmonized and it's an equilateral and it does that, whatever is supposed to happen, whether it expands or turns to light or unfolds or however that's gonna work and relate to this acceleration process, when it's equalized, it'll occur that way, it'll happen. And so, where was I?
That was a real payload you just dropped there. I don't know that I can even respond to that spontaneously.
I have no idea where I was on the list now. Who is it? Man. Well, it's a zero.
Don't go linear on me, man.
I know, right? It's a zero point trajectory. And, in order to do that, so it's like when that occurs, you could say we expand infinitesimally, or we shrink, because around that equilateral triangle, around the sides, there's a core which now becomes centered because it's spun equally. So it's like drawing a mandala or something, and the absolute infinitesimal zero point center it's now stabilized. It exists. If that's, put it this way, so when you have it rotating, you have the sides passing over a surface. Nowhere but the exact center is the majority of the weight placed, because maybe say it's bent or it's a upside down pyramid or something, because in that spot, instead of rotating and then the heat it diffuses, because now a larger surface area is sliding over it, and now, you know, the outside of the flat bottom pyramid, or just like a dish or something, a plate, if you imagine it as far as building a friction, the outside is going to be cooler than the center, because the center is constantly in contact with the same material. So the idea is, what you have to do is develop a point that's infinitely intensified enough, as well as harmonized to containing all the information of the external. And also the last video talked about this before that other one, which was the center of the self. It's talked about as a disc, where the present physical moments are all out on the disc. By, instead of stopping the disc, because we can't see beyond the moments, we can't look up, we can't stop it either, we look into the center, and then we gain the equilibrium that allows us to see where all the change is occurring at the same time. And the idea is, once that spin cycle occurs from that metaphor, we then expand to literally seeing all of time, or all of the Mobius strip at that point. And if reality is a kind of virtual whatever, well, it's unveiled at that point. And so in the same sense, when that triangle or plate or whatever reaches that escape velocity, a maximally heated point, a core occurs or exists in the center, develops, and it contains all the information of the outer consciousness on all the other ends. That'd be the memories, the consciousness, the personality, whatever you want to call it. So that's
condensed.
Was that?
It contains it all, but it's condensed in that midpoint.
Right.
Okay.
And you say it instead of shrinking or expanding, it would be like a ball or a singularity flipping inside out at that point, like a cone or something. And when that happens, all the information that is relative to who you are and your identity in this place becomes relative to everything basically in the larger system, as if you connect and incorporate with the non-self and become the whole of reality while also remaining yourself at that point. But if you're imbalanced, you become the distorted version of reality, the people that are imbalanced and aren't centering their self and centering that process, and say this realm opens up into the higher verse, they become objects, metaphorically, compared to people who actually merge on the other side and are awake and remembering all their stuff, or maybe they become amnesiacs on that side. And they're like, what just happened? It was just 10,000 years of human civilization. You have no memory of it. Because light transference doesn't operate across the dimensions, if you will, because their geometric pattern didn't enable it, because it literally didn't wrap up into a fractal, but a whole complete one, not an endless one, and flip inside out.
So is it being an amnesiac at that point, or is it simply, to stay with the computer metaphor, we have a hard drive. I have a 1 terabyte hard drive. It has all this data on it. But at any given time, I'm fundamentally computing with only the present data that is sitting in stream, in process, on the screen. That does not in any way exclude that data, because that whole 1 terabyte of data, anytime I can retrieve different aspects of that data stream. But what we're doing is, whereas there's a difference between being focused and hypnotized, and I guess that's what I'm really trying to get the distinction here, is that selective use of consciousness is actually a good thing. But what if I didn't even bother with that 1 terabyte hard drive? What if it just sat on my computer? I never used it. I never used the data. I didn't spin it up. It effectively doesn't exist.
Well, I think that's the incinerator process. I remember where I was going. I was describing how the hand tries to convince everything else that it's, you know, belongs there. Well, the whole point is all that ego, all that imbalanced stuff, that's the part of the triangle that either, or the plate or the disc of consciousness or the geometric pattern, the dome and the Hohmann sphere, that's the part that either flies off, and that's where I was going at. All right. Yeah. Last chance. But before, what you were saying is, I didn't go linear on you. I'm making a point and going back. I couldn't imagine how this would all be temporally or organized in a linear fashion. It would just be loops over loops coming back around. So the idea then that
I'm concerned about that at all. Yeah. Want linear product, go watch
somewhere else.
Really? Yeah. No, this is not linear.
Go to terrestrial radio.
You've got
to
be flexible. you've got to be able to bend with the moment, and you've got to be able to access all that data that's spinning on the outer rim of the plate. Go with it.
Yeah, and simultaneously finding that center point through the act of observation. This is tying everything together in the, this is all the stuff I want to talk about for like 2-3 months. that might be where the process itself is like a safeguard to the point where nothing can access outside of this unless it harmonizes. And that's in the point where the ego, the false perceptions, the desires, the attachments to what is the imposter aspect of the realm, it either flings off at the speed of, you know, light or whatever happens. Because I think this is a way that basically through that function, maybe even a vortex map that begins to activate through the DNA, through these processes, we attain a faster than light internal velocity in relation to the holographic system, the universe. And at that point, we deviate from the universe. Because that shouldn't be possible. But if it's a simulation type system, where all that we're doing is violating the program code and saying, now we're the administrator of the whole thing. And I'm pretty sure at that point, if one person does it, it ejects that person out of the system and they go into eternity. If everybody does it, the system collapses and everything is eternal at that point, which is one way or another we can take it. A lot of people in these projects and everything go, well, that's great, but we have to make sure there's enough people that are aware, because how are we going to basically live knowing we collapsed the system with a bunch of people playing, you know, like kids in a make-believe tent in the living room, and we just kicked out all the pillars and like flipped everything up. But again, the idea is if they don't exit, they never went in. But then say there's a soul, there's souls that are in there and they don't have to exit to get out because that, or they, you know, they don't have to make that traversing trajectory, if you will, because at that point they'll just fly out like a bat out of hell or a ghost in a machine getting ejected out. But then if that's true, well, then how would we feel knowing that they have the experience of the whole world blowing up and imploding like a baby being born and getting shocked and shot out when we could have gone back in time and been like, yo, this is like what's going on, leave little clues and hints here. And it's all tying together to what I was really hinting at, and it's coming together now to the point where if that, so that's the one way stuff gets kind of, it doesn't get past the barrier. Then say something does get from the hard drive or whatever is being stored, does get to the permanent storage. We're in short-term memory now. We're in RAM now. This whole world is RAM. When you turn the computer off, the whole world's gone. Only when people organize enough, and this is a way of describing it in, from the projects, the operations, the, whatever you want to call them. I don't know what they really call them. But people get weirded out when it's like, they don't know how to place what I'm talking about. Because some people are like, oh, it's this and that. And then I'm just like, yeah, and this is what we learned. And so whatever, and non-linearity. But basically this is, we're all in short-term memory time here. We're in the short-term memory of the omniverse. That's what this is, the RAM. And what we have to do is basically more or less verify, if you will, our file integrity, you know, like a checksum in order to basically make it to, like the big processing guy comes around and is like, and absorbed in. Some people view it like that, like it's an AI that comes and takes people and absorbs them in. It's like you pass the test. I think that's the people who are more or less aligned with the AI version of it. And they become the dark attractor, the repeller, if you will, maybe, of the cosmos. Whereas the more or less organic people, it's literally themselves on the higher level going, yeah, that makes sense. Come on, you're me, I'm you. It's the same thing. And it's like a helping hand versus like a machine checking you and making sure everything's good. And it's just completely blind and dumb to the process other than what a, you know, a cold processing system would be. I think it's, one is devoid of emotion. One is literally all emotion. It's like, oh, I love you, you're my child. One's like, oh, you passed the test, get in. And so the idea is, what would you do if you could create a simulation that was as real as reality? Eventually, I mean, don't answer that because we're going to run out of time here. And I'll just go off on a tangent on what you say, and then we're going to have to go on another around the world trip. Eventually, and maybe entertain this, eventually one might say, and some people talk about this in a philosophical sense, the only thing worth creating is something that challenges your perception of reality, of the real reality. Mm-hmm. Who would want something that's just like, that's not even really believable. All right, you know, it's like a cartoon version. But what, and especially if you can't die, you're eternal, et cetera, you know, there's another civilization where all the problems that we have now, which are literally genetic issues of light transference and energy efficiency and degrading, you know, imagine we come from a superconducting society where they don't age, they don't, you know, need, they can have a one bit of fuel that lasts the whole life. It's all this stuff that doesn't really compute here, but you look at all the stuff that that equates to here as far as the differences in, you know, decay, disease, death, distortions, memory, problems, stuff like that. All of that can be solved with a, you know, $20 if you know what you're doing and the system isn't trying to friggin' stomp you out. So if we really wanted to here, well, we could all have that type of civilization here. So then we imagine that there's a system larger than this one where all that exists. If one were to create a type of simulation, one would more or less in this transient proposal, because I'm not going to say, you know, anything is conclusive, although I'll get into, by the end of this little rant, I'll explain what I'm trying to say and some weird stuff that I've seen. What if, so the idea is then, a simulation that acts as a test that is important enough to challenge one's reality as well as be worth the process of wasting time where you can do anything in essence to get something valuable out of it. But how could you create a test in a place where you have access to everything? There are no problems in any way other than creating basically a system where you can die, you believe you can get erased and disappear from time forever, you can get eaten and assimilated into a hive mind organism that basically wants to destroy everything, you could become the background radiation of the universe and disappear, you can lose yourself and through your own folly replicate yourself as something you're not. That would be a system if we came from where we had no problems, that would be worth simulating because it would challenge our concept of reality and self. It would allow us to develop ourselves like we're playing a character development game, like a one of them long-term games. I can't think of the word, the like three
role-playing games.
Yeah, a role-playing, thank you, system, you know, of a reality system there. And it would also scare the living crap out of whoever went into it and just didn't give an F. It would teach everyone who went into it and would learn, no matter if you were super duper smart, super duper fearless, or super duper, you know, developed. Whoever went into it would absolutely learn from this type of game system that we could be playing, regardless of how it turned out. And then the idea is, if something gets to that system and it's non-essential, some memory, some programming, some person, and I say programming and stuff like that, but that's the more or less, in my term, my understanding, degraded version. There's a group of people that are going to pass through a assimilation, hive mind, technological soul matrix, and there's an organic system that has always been present. And they've probably always both been present, but one is truly original. Basically a consciousness system, more so in a pure awareness system, the celestial family, the only beings and identities that make it to the eternal celestial family are those who have an absolute necessity to be there, as if they've earned their rights, they've lost everything, done everything possible in order to, or maybe other than first, getting there to the point where there's nothing else to do but to literally become the eternal operator, administrator of this system. And I say that without the relation to programmers in today's world, but literally a loving being, like a mother-father aspect, mother-father-child aspect, like a family, literal, an energetic. It's not programmed because it's consciousness. The brain is the program. There are people who have just the brain, no soul. And there are people who have no brain, just a soul, which, you know, is kind of a shifty way to look at things.
Yeah, but absolutely.
But that's the idea, that there is a program creator, overlord, and then there is a soul essence. One has emotion, one doesn't. That's the whole idea behind that. So saying, you know, there's some that get deleted off of the hard drive because they didn't make the cut isn't quite the same, although that does correlate for the AI system, although imagine the AI system has its own rules to that. And so that's kind of the interplay of that. And so then the idea is that there's that leeway after we get there and we're on the other side, and it's like we're in the presence of the creator, or just the fact that we can see all of time and space that we correspond to physically in the now, in some type of collective environment in with different parameters, if you will, a super realm. And at that point, what's going to happen from there? Well, those who are attempting to integrate into that society and are basically more or less douchebags and don't understand, excuse my language, but don't understand that harmonious aspect of
perfect words.
Yeah, that like evil asshole devil being dummies. That's how it is. Because on that side there's no fear. So it wouldn't be like, oh my god, it's be like, what are you doing? This isn't gonna work, not gonna work, you're gonna break your plate, not happening. And there's a system, a safeguard system, where there's that chance and there's the second death, the review, whatever you want to call it. And so that's one. I hope that didn't mess up the recording. I exited.
No, we're good. Don't worry about that. We're
okay. And so there's that system, which is in that singularized or across the singularity. We've met beings that claim to be from the other side of that singularity, and we're explaining a lot of this to us. And from their perspective, this realm exists because they enacted what is called an ancestor simulation, because they wanted to know where their DNA came from. And they didn't have access to it because there was some type of dimensional barrier or rift or great catastrophe that occurred. And apparently that's the act of them becoming them and us leading up to whatever that is, which is as well what we apparently came from, because time makes a big loop. And part of this is tied into the operations where there are timelines that have to close out because they jump started history using these devices, which created time loops that shrink every time they're ran. They're programs that have a null point that they reach in their runtime. Really, really interesting stuff. Besides the apocalypse, the Armageddon stuff, all those programs that are entered into reality. Okay, so the light side of that is, they figure it out in the other parts of the control system, intelligence, these control agencies, power groups, not the like the evil controllers, if you will. And they figured out how to literally take the code of this version of this loop that's repeating itself, and basically it's an Armageddon code somebody wrote into society accidentally as well as on purpose to rule, and they're erasing it and writing it over with one that kind of, say there's a gap between that, they're filling in that gap with enough energy to get us across to the point where as soon as we get across, that whole thing just implodes on itself. And only the people that actually follow that and are aware enough to make that shift are going to more or less make it, but that's what would happen anyway. But the idea is that that past erases itself. That's the weird part. But the idea is that then, so there's a, imagine that that's the one way is after the singularity, and the other way is before, in the act of transversing or traversing, where the ego gets, it's like fitting the camel through the eye of a needle. The ego doesn't fit, it doesn't compress right, it doesn't expand again. When the expansion comes back out, it's all jumbled, or the memory is just gone. And the person comes back out on the other end, they have no recollection of who they are, what they just went through, all that got picked out the other end. So the idea is on the other end, if there's a incinerative type deal situation, there is a replay, there is a last chance. This is where also where I take so much time to go through these things. There's a last chance to reclaim your sovereignty, your rightful presence in eternity. And that is through, and this is also a last chance there, the replay. And then at the acceleration where your person will be ripped into pieces, ripped in half, bifurcated, torn into an opposing being, if you will, a half and half of that doesn't equal the whole. It's not how it works. Harmonically, you can't rip something that's a trinity in half and get two wholes. It just turns into the background psychic energy. And so during that acceleration, a person that's the first last chance, there's a repentance. And this is what it's called, like in the religious stuff, where it's made to look like a joke now, so nobody knows that you could do this. As well, if you try to abuse it, it doesn't work. You can't be like, I'm going to do all this crazy, nasty stuff. And as soon as the end comes, I'm going to be like, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to. No, that's not actually going to work. It doesn't mean anything. But the idea is, if that acceleration cycle begins and a person is latched onto the ego, ripped in like tentacles of the false reality are wrapped around their skull, their energy, harmony, their geometry, if they let go, if the fear increases, because everything magnifies to the point of a god or being with a god or something like that, everything magnifies, with the fear magnifies, the hate, the lust, all that stuff, the addictive qualities, the program is basically the self and the non-self. If a person has that aspect and it's not the self in a circle around the non-self or the non-self in a circle around the self, but it's distorted, okay, it will rip them apart. Their last chance is to literally be like, I was wrong. None of that is me. It's not me. That, F you, you're not me. That, not me, I don't care either. Don't care about that. Don't care. And if they let go in that moment, they accelerate enough and they retain enough charge as long as they're meaningful with it, because it's a three-part motion where it's a harmonization, acceleration, and then a releasing of the charge where it's building up, getting hot, and then it rockets off and leaves the trajectory of the system. It expands beyond the parameters of the dimension, if you will. And so if they do that, they'll make it. But they say when the people that do that, that make it, have the least amount of energy out of anyone other than the people that don't make it at all. Because at that point, you waited until the very last moment to strip away all of the material, the psychic material, the organization, the memories, the information, all of that, in order to strip down to just the bare essentials and then beam across through that method, the same method. But, so they lose a lot in doing that. The other aspect of this, somebody, you can interrupt me because I have it written down.
So it's kind of like waiting to the last minute to get in shape for the marathon. Right? Where you can still do it, but you're dead and you're going to have no energy for weeks afterwards. So what you're basically saying is we need to get ourselves physically, emotionally, mentally, psychically, energetically, spiritually in line so that when we get our chance to go through, to pass through, we don't spend so much energy trying to get through that we're just have nothing when we get to the other side. We can prepare ourselves now by the way we're mindful, by the way we use our self-awareness, our integrity, our intention, all of that kind of stuff, get ourselves geometrically lined up so that we can have the smoothest passage through. So we go through remembering who we are, what we are, where we came from, why we're here, and what we are doing.
Yes. Yeah, and in a way,
because it goes back to what I said earlier about spiritual disciplines. the reason why you do the discipline is to be able to access it on an ongoing basis. It integrates into who you are and what you do. It no longer is an outside activity. It's integrated.
Yeah.
And really everything we're talking about goes back to the integrity of the whole. Basically, restoring, preserving, maintaining, and strengthening whole integrity so that we're hologram integrity in a way that we're not spinning out there at the last minute trying to grab enough energy to spin off. We actually are already in the orbit. I just mixed enough metaphors there that...
Yeah. You basically just made Mongolian barbecue there.
You know I did, yeah. It's great, too. Very tangy.
This is necessary.
There's no straight line way. And what I like is, I think what Aug did was he really did kind of put the bow on the whole thing. Because everybody's like, well, what are you talking about and what's the purpose of this? The purpose is that I think we have a sense that we are at this nexus point in time, space-time, that there's a rendering of the veil, a separating of partitions and decisions that have to be made. The world is not going to hold the way it's illusory been held together for so long. Reality asserts itself. Real reality, we don't know what that is. Because core reality is simply, again, the embryonic system that we stem from. It needs to reassert itself energetically.
Yep.
And so that energetic system has everything is type of a transaction or an exchange system for energy. Our choices and our emissions and then our beliefs, basically the perspectives we hold, they're recorded in our energy. If there's a change measurable, whether it's experienced or physical or not, it's recorded. Just because we think, you know, they have technology now and this is becoming mainstream. Let alone they have stuff years ago that could literally bring your thoughts on screen.
Absolutely.
Like a TV. Yeah. So we think, you know, a fart sound or something in our head, and just because nobody can see or smell or hear that, it doesn't mean it's not there. They can now, in public reality or mainstream, I don't even know what you want to call this, in the construct, they're telling people, you can put electrodes on the head and bring out the ideas and decode them using algorithms and get like a fuzzy image or even the words of what a person is saying. And they have stuff in private sector that can literally, if you think of a friggin' scene with 15 different zoo animals doing jumping jacks and aerobics, it'll come out pixel by pixel onto a monitor, and they can literally recreate it as part of the looking technology that can do that with the energy of time, the probabilities, and bring that into a monitor.
Yes, I've experienced this technology.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I think we all have.
This is one of their favorites for me, so...
You know, there a lot of people are learning too. These people who got access to this.
You know, it really is down to the wire in terms of, look, we're not just putting a bunch of oscillations out there. We're not flapping our lips. Pardon the crudeness. We're not sitting here jerking off. We're trying to get something out. And there's 100,000 different ways to say this. The synergy that I think happens when we get together in this group or in various other groups, because, you know, I know Aug, you interact a lot, and we kind of plug in and plug out of different groups and different host guest situations. And the point is to communicate this in so many ways
that
everyone gets it. Because everybody thinks differently. Yeah.
Everyone who wants to get it. Not everyone's going to get it, but everyone who wants to and has spent a good portion of energy, time, and intention trying to understand this, we'll find a way to get it. So,
unless we've got somewhere else to go, well, I kind of feel like we want to wrap it at this point because I don't want people fatigued. I want them to go back through this again, because here's the way you listen to an interview. You know, if you've gone through it this far with us, a couple of things have resonated. Something has hit your core. There was a something that somebody said and they spun off of that. And that's the part you want to grab a hold of. Discard everything else. You know, aside from the trolls on YouTube, the valid. Hey, how you doing out there, guys? Did you get your check from the agency this week? Great. It's way too small money for what you're doing.
I have their journey as well.
But, I mean, really the whole point is that this is not a talk show. We're not sitting here trying to entertain anyone. What we're really trying to do is find as many pulses to put this out. And when one of those pulses hits you, grab it and go with it. And don't spend a lot of time with your monkey mind trying to analyze, because the resonance pattern, once you pick it up, is not that complex. A lot of the stuff that we're talking about in commonality. We don't sit around and devise and plot all this stuff. Well, Aug does, but we don't. you know, this is a wellspring of common experience and common consciousness that's coming together. And it's not just us. There's other people out there that are putting out great information and these little feelers, these pulses as well. So, you know, it's not linear. It's not entertainment. It's not a talk show. It's simply us saying, look, here's where we are. This is what's going on. And here's some things you can consider doing about it. And that's kind of my little wrap up. Go around the table, and Emily and Aug, feel free to just kick in there.
So I think I'm with Randy. We can wrap up now. I have a few things that are sort of separate that I wanted to ask Aug. So maybe we'll kind of wrap a bow around this and end this, but we'll keep recording on the other side. So if we decide that what I want to ask him is relevant and other people might like to hear, then we can do that. But let's go ahead and wrap up. And yeah, I feel the same way as Randy. You know, basically a lot of this, sometimes I feel like we're just finding different ways to say the same kinds of things over and over again, but it's for us and for everyone else, because
it is for us. Yeah. And it's us finding the other people, finding the others, just like that.
We're having to help each other to unlock our memories, our experiences, our hidden gifts and talents and all that kind of stuff. And sometimes, you know, sometimes you say things was one way and someone doesn't get it. And then you say exactly the same thing, but you say it another way and it suddenly sparks someone for someone. So we're going to keep, you know, that actually, Aug, I really have to commend you, because you spend a lot of time going over a lot of dense information. And a lot of it is you every day having to come up with a new way to try and restate or clarify or whittle down something you've already said. And you've been really relentless in continuing to work at it. And so, you know, I know there's a lot of people that really appreciate you. And that's just what we're trying to do here, is we're trying to find different ways to coax whatever is trying to come out of all of us. And we include all of you who are listening in that. Coax it out so we can work together and start sewing together the quilt, so we can have the whole picture and decide what it is we want and need to do, where to take things to a place that is of our choosing, as opposed to where we've just been plopped into something that we're like, what the fuck? So, Aug, would you like to, do you have anything you kind of want to end with?
I have like 15 tangents. If you'll permit me for like 5 or 6 minutes to try and wrap up what I began,
sure.
Because it's weird. They all, I don't think there's anything else. It'll probably take about 6 minutes exactly if I get to it, but all the stuff from like exactly before all of this kind of began, it's all, I'm gonna be like led back up to it.
Go for it.
The main thing about that, what you said, is basically there's the main principles, there's different versions, and they're all layers from a core reality, which can be described in different ways, like different versions of ourselves, different versions of the timeline, time streams. And the goal is to organize with the one that has the most or highest frequencies to generate integration with that core reality, because that is essentially the one that's present in all of them. The variables that are the most present in one are the most present in all of them, and that's the actual over reality, which is like a hive reality, if you want to kind of make that transliteration, if you will. And so then the one thing Randy said is about the embryonic aspect of what's going on here. And this is kind of related to the, if this is an ancestor simulation, and in that tangent, which I didn't complete, is that if this basically the life review, okay, where we say we leave the plane, we get plugged into a living technology device or a being who or we, our higher self reviews everything. That's the same as if we leave this time and our soul goes into a future civilization where they have a system that they plug you in and show you where you were and feed your memories back through, maybe for those who did not make it across that singularity gap. Whereas there are transdimensional computers here recording the whole civilization below the ground in Bugetji or Busegi Mountain, however you're going to say it, or in Antarctica, where they're recording the bio emissions of every being on the planet. And they're transdimensionally transferring the information to a future civilization in another time stream to the point where now that everything has advanced enough in both civilizations for us to send it and them to, oh, they've always been there receiving it. If we hit that Armageddon, at this point, it's simply the apocalypse where we zap through on the other end and all the people who don't have their memories can literally operate through this system. And what they experience when this happens, and this is the strangest thing, but this is what goes on, you wake up and you're seeing, they're like, are you ready to go and go? And you wake up here and live life. And at the end of that, you wake up over there and they're like, how was it? Did you get what you wanted? And this, if this is the simulation, it's the same as if this is the life review that happens after you die, basically. And when you wake up, when you die here, you wake up to the real reality. And we kind of step outside the machine or the booth or we unplug or whatever. And it's, we were actually always there. But that's where this temporal paradox exists. And it's a, you don't use your analytical mind to try and comprehend that because it won't work. And don't also buy into it too much because you might get a big ass brain or something. Something weird will happen. But the idea kind of, outside. Oh, so then the to complete the idea of how what we really could be doing or are supposed to do, however you want to look at it, is whether we're going to be in both realities simultaneously through the knowledge that the conscious mind doesn't have direct access to experientially, but can access by going into the dream time, and we send that back, and we have to package information which are like directives of what to do when we get back to reality, and when we do that enough, we basically develop a blueprint, a seed reality, a plan, and we can map ourselves out from that perspective. It's like going to the dream to build a reality and in the reality connecting with the dream and being like, I made all this up in my dream world. In that, when we live by that, we're actually making more sense. Yeah. We're living by the truer version of ourselves because we can't lie in our dreams. Whatever we're feeling is what's going on. It's what's in our minds. It's letting us know. So in that way, that singularity where they cross is kind of like a reflection system. It's a dimensional reflection system, as well as the acceleration shooting everything out, and as well as the kind of last chance where it's either going to get saved or it's going to get tossed out. It's a reflection system where what one brings is what they get back at them. And it's a boundary, it's a keeper, it's a safeguard from non-essential stuff getting into what you could call eternity. Whereas if a person, I spoke this in the last video, goes into the escape, the exit, the formulation, the formative embryonic process with duality and ego-mindedness based in dominance and like basically a lack of internal control, therefore through projecting a desire to take control over others, they wake up and have a being doing that to them. They create a counterpart mirror image in the higher dimensions that is themselves coming back to basically bitch slap them out of reality. And so the only way to get through the barrier is to have a non-duality viewpoint where the basis of this in first, that harmonization aspect is through viewing yourself, creating, okay, so we're in the realm, the act of observation creates a feedback loop, which is projected out into the holographic realm. When we are aware of this, we are aware of the fact of the reality of the feedback system based upon our awareness or observation. Therefore, when we are aware of that, the reality is created out of our act of observation, and our observation becomes the center of reality. That is the eye in the middle of the mandala, which is also the center, the top of a pyramid, if you look at it. And so the eye is the center because when the eye is the center, then there's a clear shot up and down the toroid into the higher and lower layers. It's the act of observation that does that, that opens up those channels. And so the idea of how to make use of this or not get spat back out or whatever that is, it's basically to be, and this is kind of confusing, but it's to be selfless, to be free of constraints, to be free of attachments that limit us, that convert us from a whole free-flowing essence without a really defined image, if you will, into something that's squared in a grid pattern, connected in relation to other people, and these principles, these ideas that are constructed and given to us by some person who really doesn't give a crap about what they're doing to us, or does but doesn't care about us empathy. I'm not going to try and repronounce that. So in that, there's harmonization. If there's ego, it's ego centralized on truth. If there's that center of being, it's centralized around the meaning of this universe, basically, instead of something we make up that takes from it, basically, because we make it up. But when it's in harmony, then we're not adding or taking away. We're flowing with the river, by going with that. And so the image, and it's the ego not based on the image, which is known when we are aware of that interplay between the singularity and the realities, the plethora of realities and the singular reality. We will know then that the ego of no, I know the truth and I am this defined self, that's an illusion. That's a lie. We're lying to ourselves. It's dishonesty, spiritual dishonesty, if we're doing that. And so then as long as the ego is used for growth and not games, then it's not destructive at that point. And so then the final part of this is basically that the information, the knowledge, the self has to be known by the soul. And this is what the project sought to experiment with as well. They did it in crappy ways, but not even the projects, but the people who took over the projects. It has to be known by the soul, or maybe it was always like that. And the people who broke in and fixed it and rescued a lot of the kids and stuff like that were the people who never went the projects, but came out of that other civilization. So when it's known by the soul, it's not in the conscious mind. It's in the nature of the being. It's in the background. It's not by the memory or by the choice, but it's literally in the subconscious and the unconscious as if it's second nature. And to do that, we have to act upon it enough and initiate action enough in this selfless manner of corresponding to ourself beyond that singularity, enough in waking reality that it becomes transliterated into the unconscious and the transcendent reality. And in that way, the waking self knows that transcendent essence, and it doesn't have to be reminded through a rule, a law, somebody putting us in line, whatever it is. Then we can blow up in an explosion. Whatever happens, it's still there. You can't take it away. You can't, make it go away. And so a large portion of that is one has to take a leap of faith somewhere along that route, because like the Mobius strip we're on, we cannot consciously see the other end and know that's really what it is and that's where we're going. We can have these visions and dreams and this experience to push us there, where we can't take a magnifying glass, a telescope, a research crew and point out and say, like, this is what's going to happen when I do this. It doesn't work that way. And so it's inherently in this game that we have to kind of take that faith and go with it and make our dream a reality in that sense. And so every energy transaction in this realm accounts to something, whether we see it or not. We have to make 60% of the transactions we create across the singularity to the point of initiation, neutrality, and truth based upon ourself in this harmonious viewpoint of the larger version, rather than attachment to the smaller waking version that we have consciousness, that we have attachment to or entanglement with here, because that cannot go in fear. The only thing you get is the basic principles expanded in the other end. And and then the last thing is, I don't know if that was 6 minutes, but the last thing, it's probably closest I've gotten before. The last thing is that regarding the temporal non-location, basically, I'm going to skip this part, but if we're in an infinitesimally small point, conscious or awareness by definition is non-locally referenced to this waking reality. You can never actually bring your awareness into the moment. You can only get a surrounding proximity. First, you can only get a shadow on either end. Eventually, you surround it with proximity and you can't actually get to it. Otherwise, you've stopped time completely. And so by definition, then, the true reality is temporally non-local. It's wherever we're from is beyond time. It's beyond all happening. Whether that's then, trans civilization from the future, whatever you want to look at it, I don't know. But the idea then, all those processes of developing those principles into an alignment of harmony, truth, compassion, creativity, free will, and all of it through free will, meaning nobody can do it for you. It nourishes, acknowledges, and doesn't plant, because I don't think you can create this. That embryonic, formative agent, essence, the pregnant aspect of us, waiting to grow the seed of the core of the original blueprint of the soul, the seed, the soul awareness, the seed awareness, which then basically expands kind of like a plant or a tree back into some larger image, which from its perspective, it expanded out to get to here and is actually contracting back through. And that's where we actually have two vortices on either end of one another, and we're in a double toroid or double vortex system. And that view is the original intention, the same awareness that began, that goes through this process of expansion, contraction to something new, and comes back with new experience. And we could get back to that. The pathway back is a keeping and attaining basically the original goal, which is just experience. It's just knowing and not having an agenda to twist up something in some system that doesn't actually orient to the original, because we had no need to do that. There's no lack. And to do that, to gain that, we let go of all that holds us back. And it's literally that simple, but you can go on for hours and probably days, probably go on for weeks, honestly. Have at some points.
All right. It was very, very good, Aug. That was, I think that was a good wrap up there, and I like the way you crystallized some of those points.
Absolutely.
Okay. So again,
I try. Sorry for rambling.
So we'll end the regular show here. Maybe we'll go into a few after show minutes and whatever. So, so that's it for tonight. So the truth is out there. It's inside of you. Find it. The people.